Audio. All right.
Yahshua, you are so wonderful. You're the only one, the King of kings. Every knee shall bow before your majesty. You're Yahshua, you are so marvelous. Your glory outshines the sun. You are worthy of all the honor. You are the Son of Yah. There is none like you. You sacrificed your life so we could love you. Your love is beyond compare. Your mercy Yahshua, you are so beautiful. Your attributes are more lustrous than gold. Thank you for giving us eyes to see your splendor. Your loving nature is the greatest sight to behold. There is none like you. We give our hearts, our time, our all to you. There is none like you. There is none like you.
Good evening. My name is Eunice, and I will be your moderator for this evening. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. The school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word, our Son, is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord or God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, We teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, and court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, a so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This evening, we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. We will have a song in the midst, and our scripture lesson will be Joshua, the 24th chapter.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for being patient with us. We are your faithful sons. We're here to learn your purpose and your plan of salvation. We are living in perilous times. We can see how the world is shaking. Purpose, we know that. Keep us safe and make us with the flame of knowing and the willingness of knowing this teaching, because this teaching is one of a kind. Thank you for giving us this knowledge and understanding, because it's something beautiful. You just take little time, be patient, and you will see some of the things Yahweh or you want to join us. I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say Alleluia. Alleluia.
There's a bright new goes. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Tonight we will be reading the 24th chapter of Joshua. I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible. It's not a King James or a Dowie, it's the Holy Name Bible. Critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Traina. He was with the Scripture Research Association. And Dr. Traina was a member of the Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Joshua, the 24th. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges. And for their officers, and they presented themselves before Elohim. And Joshua said unto all the people, Thus saith Yahweh Elohim of Israel, Your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served idols. And they took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. And I gave unto Isaac Jacob and Esau. And I gave unto Esau Mount Seir to possess it. But Jacob and his children went down into Egypt. I sent Moses also and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt according to that which I did among them. And afterward I brought you out, and I brought your fathers out of Egypt, and you came unto the sea. And the Egyptians pursued after your fathers with chariots and horsemen unto the Red Sea. And when they cried unto Yahweh, he put darkness between you and the Egyptians, and brought the sea upon them, and covered them. And your eyes have seen what I have done in Egypt. And ye dwelt in the wilderness a long season. And I brought you into the land of Amorites, and which dwelt on the other side of Jordan. And they fought with you, and I gave them into your hand, that you might possess their land. And I destroyed them from before you. Then Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, arose and warred against Israel and sent and called Balaam, the son of Beor, to curse you. But I would not hearken unto Balaam. Therefore he blessed you still. So I delivered you out of his hand. And ye went over Jordan and came unto Jericho. And the men of Jericho fought against you, the Amorites and the Perizzites, the Canaanites and the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And I delivered them into your hand. And I sent the hornet before you, which drave them out from before you, even the two kings of the Amorites, but not with thy sword, nor with thy bow. And I have given you a land from which ye did not labor, and cities which you have not built. And ye dwell in them of the vineyards and olive yards which ye planted, not do you eat. Now therefore, fear Yahweh and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the idols which your fathers served on the other side of the flood. And in Egypt, and ye serve, and serve ye Yahweh. And if it seems evil unto you to serve Yahweh, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether idols which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the idols of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve Yahweh. And the people answered and said, Far be it from us that we should forsake Yahweh to serve idols. For Yahweh our Elohim, he it is that brought us up and our fathers out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, and which did those great signs in our sight, and preserved us in all the way wherein we went, and among all the people through whom we passed. And Yahweh drave out from before us all the people, even the Amorites which dwell in the land. Therefore will we serve Yahweh, for he is our Elohim. And Joshua said unto the people, ye cannot serve Yahweh, for he is an holy Elohim. He is a jealous El. He will not forgive your transgressions, nor your sins. If ye forsake Yahweh and serve idols, then he will turn and do you hurt and consume you. After that he hath done you no, have done you good. And the people said unto Joshua, nay, but we will serve Yahweh. And Joshua said unto the people, ye are witnesses against yourselves that ye have chosen Yahweh to serve him. And they said, we are witnesses. Now therefore put away, said he, the deities which are among you, and incline your heart unto Yahweh Elohim of Israel. And the people said unto Joshua, Yahweh our Elohim will we serve, and his voice will we obey. So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day, and set them a statute and an ordinance in Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of Elohim, and took a great stone, and set it up there under an oak that was by the sanctuary of Yahweh. And Joshua said unto all the people, behold, this stone shall be a witness unto us, for it hath heard all the words of Yahweh which he spoke unto us. It shall be therefore a witness unto you, lest ye deny your Elohim. So Joshua let the people depart, every man unto his inheritance. And it came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-serah, which is in Mount Ephraim, on the north side of the hill of Gash. And Israel served Yahweh all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that overlived Joshua, and which had known all the works of Yahweh that he had done for Israel. And the bones of Joseph, which the children of Israel brought up out of Egypt, buried they in Shechem, in a parcel of ground which Jacob bought of the sons of Hamor, the father of Shechem, for 100 pieces of silver, and it became the inheritance of the children of Joshua. And Eleazar, the son of Aaron, died, and they buried him in a hill that pertained to Phinehas, his son, which was given him in Mount Ephraim. That was Joshua, the 24th chapter. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas and Dr. Wunsch. Tonight is Thursday night. It is our lecture or testimony night. If anyone has anything to say, please raise your hand or through Zoom, let me know.
Hi.
Gregory? Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. I don't think it's too selfish of me to try to share
when and why I became part of IDMR. Sometimes, I hope I'm not taking up too much time, but I was at a usual trip to Walmart, Upland, and this Kenneth Grubbs and Aaron, maybe Brian, was in McDonald's in Walmart, and they were people who shared getting people to vote and petition sign for the political people arena. And they went to a chapter in Fontana. And so I was pleased with the health part, holy place, most holy place. And they had charts on the wall just like here. And I was almost flabbergasted that there was an Ontario chapter, because they took me to have prime rib dinner. I told them a couple of times I ate prime rib dinner in LA, and they took me to Carol's up on Mountain by 8th Street, and the waitress took pictures of us eating chocolate mousse cake. And so I'm always interested in hearing like a chapter of the Holy Scripture read, like Mr. Bud, if I can say his last name sometime. And I just feel like it's a base for me to get that out of my mind so I can feel more compatible to you all, because you seem so more advanced. I just met a lady. She is in... Okay. Oh, wow. She is in L.A. Her name is Dorian, and we're not really playing phone tag, but she gave me an address I could write to in L.A., and I told her about you all out here in Ontario. And I just like now, as I began in Fontana, things just got more and more interesting, so that's why I kept coming back. And I think that's about all. They worship at a Faith Foundation place, but she does seem to know quite a bit, like you all, about Yahweh and Elohim and Yeshua.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gregory, or Gregory. Do we have anyone else that would like to have anything to say? Okay, I won't take that much time, but I think this is every opportunity that I get, you know, to say something about my Heavenly Father, how He has blessed us, and I'll say me, for coming into any kind of understanding of this teaching. And it's more so now I'm coming to realize that there is nothing else more important than learning about this gospel. We have been given the basics, 1, 2, 3, blood, water, spirit. We've been shown of the vision of Moses. We've been told about the transgression. We've been given a lot of information. I've been given a lot of information. And it's just coming to me that Yahweh has had mercy on me to come into a realization what this is all about and the vision. Knowledge, yes. Like the law and the prophet, the knowledge is good. We need that. But it just doesn't stop there. There's an understanding of what this really is all about, being able to see the spirit itself operating. Like we say, we know our heartbeat, but it's not caused by us. Well, then that goes for every single thing. That goes for the good, the bad, the ugly. And the thing that He has made me look up the word, trash. Because these concepts, the way we came from birth all the way through, it's been trash. But that's all that we had. Just like these children down here, that's all the law that they had. And it was for a purpose. Well, what we had was for a purpose too. But because we are on this side of the cross, not back under the law, we're given the opportunity to see the true reason why there was an old law and the new law that he said in Jeremiah. You know, not like the one that I made with their fathers when I brought them by the hand. But I'm going to write this one in your heart and mind. I'm coming to find out and see and know. It is written in our hearts and mind. Stand still and see the salvation. You got to get out of the way. You got to look at how your little demons, they come through fear. They use emotions. They use whatever is to distract you from the truth. Because sooner or later, you got to come forth. If that spirit is in you, you got to come forth. That is the will of Yahweh. And be thankful to glorify him as he teaches us that he, from pure spirit, taking on a shape and form that created everything and then manifested in a physical body. It is really true. And we are that which we've been looking for. I can't say I got all that clarity with it, but I'm just thankful for the little bit that he has allowed me to see. And as far as what I would like to know, I would like to know a lot. I don't doubt that he can't bring me to that awareness and to that knowledge. But it just, when it is time, it is time. But I can't do anything about it. I can only do what my instructor have already sat here and said. Just go through the pattern, read, rehearse. Hey, it's Yahweh that gives the increase. And when I learned to stand still and quit chasing those thoughts of what I'm seeing, no. Maria, yesterday I had a nice time over to your house. Now we were doing, you know, household stuff. That seemed like it was in, you know, regular stuff, but it wasn't. That was a union that Yahweh had set up. And I like seeing things like that just fall with no work that you and I did. That is Yahweh manifesting himself in the flesh. It says oftentimes, but until you can actually see the spirit really, it ain't, you didn't have nothing to do with it. You don't have nothing to do with what you understand. You cannot understand. You cannot know unless it is given to you, which is given to you freely. When you get, he gives it to you freely, it's the truth. It is the truth. So I really have been enjoying, and I'm not saying I'm anywhere. I'm just thankful that my vision of what I thought I knew and what I thought I was seeing, that he's had mercy on me in these last days to show me something else about him. That is worth more than anything. And I got my family there, and it's like I got to start teaching them with all the things that's going on in the world. Do you know people really think they're going to live forever? That is a second thought in their mind. 22,000 people died over in that earthquake. Do you think that fazed people? No, they still running around shooting and doing, you know, And some of them that I read, God don't even, look, some of this stuff is just all make-believe. You know, it's like the sense of reality. It's just not there. It's like, what do people, what are they thinking? That we are going to live forever? Or do they even consider? And now, you know, I have to consider also, you know, how. Not me, but I ask Joshua to show me new people with my family, how to get them, how to teach them. And the family that already knows about the erroneous Jesus, how to deal in with them. But then when I get put into that position, hey, I can only do study, read, come to class, listen. Yahweh always leave a message here for us. We come here, all, you know, no doubt. So I know he be in the house. And I listen for that. And sometimes it don't feel good, but you know what? That's good. That's good. He's taking us through these things because we got to change our thought. It's got to get off what we see. It's what is causing that to be. And if it keeps coming at you, you need to look and see whether or not it's telling you something. And it's not about the other person or not about something outside. You know, it's all about what is in your heart and mind. Where is your soul? And are you confident and assured of this teaching and what it has given to you, that in the last days, you know it's going to stand. You know where you are with Yahweh. And you know you are going back. And that this, that he, lamb slain before the foundation of the world. And we are being introduced or taken back from whence we came. But we must go through the death of this mind that we put on. And you know what? I didn't realize that things that I just thought was just everyday common stuff, I didn't realize, didn't even question. Where did I learn that from? See, all those just things, I mean, I never questioned where I learned all this from and why did I learn. You know, what is it really? And I come to look at some stuff, I don't know. I just do it because that's the way. It's not what I thought it was. So with that, I thanks for the time. But believe me, my heart is open to praise Yahweh in it all. And I am so thankful that he has allowed me to see it is him. Whether or not things be cracking down at home. You know, they had an announcement today about a shooting, you know, or threatened at the high school and stuff like that. See, I know I need to get I call them my kids, so they can be stable, because we are going to hear more and more and more of all these horrendous type things happening. And I don't want them to be shaken. They to know that Yahweh is causing all things. Not to say not to be mindful, but Yahweh is causing all things. In that, you can rest with it too. If you truly believe, you can rest with it. He does. And there's nothing anybody can do about it. And sometimes one of the things that comes is so beautiful is that it's already done. That's what sort of put me back in focus and saying, Why are you tripping? You don't even know what you're tripping for. Because it's not about the thing. It's about seeing Yahweh manifesting and seeing He is sitting on your throne, directing your every thought, your every path. And you can rest with it because the man's got control of everything. He's a good husband, man. He really is. And with that, I will say all glory and praises go to Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah. Our next speaker for this evening will be the Dean, Dr. Marlon Love.
I'll try to stay in one spot as much as possible. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's good to be here. And I thank Yahweh for allowing us to gather once again with the things that are happening here and abroad, always. I enjoyed the testimony that was given by Eunice. I enjoyed the scripture reading, Joshua, the 24th chapter. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate you reading it again, Bud, with that. And also the speaker of what was expressed by Mr. Gregory. Thank you for joining and sitting in once again to class.
Yeah.
We all need guidance here. And we help one another in order to encourage one another, in order to learn and to know something about our Heavenly Father. Now, there's been a lot of things going on in my circle as well. And I had Joshua read for a reason. And I think we could just go ahead and give a lecture on this flood business. The flood. How many floods were there? I'll say it that way.
Are you talking about the biblical stories of the flood?
Yeah.
There's the flood that was the water with Noah, mm-hmm. and then there's a spiritual flood that came afterwards with Yahshua pouring out the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. That's a flood. That's a baptism, right? Mm-hmm. Immersion. Okay. Okay, that's fine. Like I said, we're not going to know everything. You follow it in our state and condition. But the things that we do know and the people that we do come across, there's a way to deliver the message to them. You follow? I had someone, I don't know how old he is, probably in his 20s, overhearing me talking with someone today about class, and I used the names Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And when I got off the phone, he said, "Well, you know, I wasn't trying to intrude on you." And I spoke loud so that he would listen, you know, so it wasn't nothing that it was bad that he, because we weren't saying anything egregious or anything. And so he asked about the names, you know, he asked about what it is that I understand, what is that doctrine. Never heard that language before or that jargon before, you know, and I go about to explain to him that this is a school and it's not a church, and that sin comes up, and felt that he was sinning. He doesn't go to any religious things. He thinks they lie a lot, and he doesn't go. He's familiar with church, and he was familiar with the Bible, and it's topical as kids of that age would may know, but he felt he sins. Mm-hmm. I don't want to talk too much. I'm a sinner. I said, why do you think you a sinner, you know? And so just this small pitter-patter talk with him. And in the end of the conversation, because you're not going to lay it all, I'm at work anyway, so I can't go too far, too deep. And yet at the end of the conversation, I left him with a happy spirit. Man, I'd like to talk with you again. You know, that's the least I can do to talk with somebody that doesn't have much information, and I can't bombard them with a lot of scripture, right? But yet there's enough things of how you breathe. When you inhale, yah, and you exhale, you use a child, the first thing that a child does, he screams or yells the name of yah, yah, cries out. You follow? When anybody passes away. They don't, you know, they exhale, they expire,
right.
They breathe out way, you follow? So everybody has that universal understanding, you see? And so when you put that on somebody that's not familiar with the Bible, and you give them the name of understanding that Lord is a title and God is a title, you got a problem. And I often use, what was the last letter added to the American alphabet? Mm-hmm. I haven't met a soul, from teachers to professors to laymen to anybody, they ever answer that question. They'll come back 5 or 10 minutes later after they Googled it,
yeah.
And they give me the answer.
Yeah.
Letter J, right? Yeah. They don't know why the letter J was moved to the 10th character in the alphabet. And then they can't explain why a Hebrew name would be Jesus other than, well, we're in America. It's just how it works. And that's not the truth, you follow? So these are things you can pepper people with to make them kind of prick them to engage in a conversation, right? And like Eunice said, there's going to be a time when they're going to want to know more than you're going to really want to share, because you're going to be paying attention to Yahshua, right? And knowing and being about his business, mm-hmm. is where to go and what to do. But when he sets you amongst a group in order to express something, you're going to want to need to have something to say. Mm-hmm. Because they're coming to hear something. You follow? Now, Joshua, I think go ahead and get down to the 14th verse.
14th verse.
Somewhere around there. Talks about Abraham.
Now therefore, fear Yahweh and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the idols which your fathers served on the other side of the flood.
Now this is Joshua talking to this tribe, or the children of Israel. Read.
And in Egypt, and serve ye Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
And if it seem evil unto you to serve Yahweh, choose you this day whom ye will serve. Whether idols which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood.
On the other side of the flood that your fathers served. Read.
Or the idols of the Amorites, mm-hmm. in whose land ye dwell.
So you got people on the other side of the flood. And my question is, what flood is that?
I looked up Strong's definition for flood.
Oh, we have a Zoom participant. Wonderful. Go ahead.
Strong's definition for flood, yep. The root word neha, from a stream, including the sea, especially the Nile, Euphrates, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Figuratively, prosperity, flood, or river.
Okay. You got a flood or a river. Yeah, go ahead and have a seat, Doc. I'm not going to move around too much. Okay. It'll be all right. If I can get it out. So we're dealing with flood as a topic, I think, right now. And we're reading Joshua. And Joshua is talking about a flood on the other side of that parents did. You follow?
With Abraham and the flood, that started on in 2.
Well, yeah, let's grab it.
Oh, okay.
Let's grab it.
All right. I'll do 1. Okay, 24 and 1.
We're going to reread, and we skip down and paraphrase, but we're going to talk about it here, Joshua.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sean, for that bit of information, because we want to keep that mind of the river and particularly Euphrates.
Yeah, that's a good clue. Yeah.
Go ahead and read.
And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers, and they presented themselves before Elohim. And Joshua said unto all the people, thus said Yahweh Elohim of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served idols. And I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac.
Okay, that's what I wanted right there. Because sometimes we get not sure what that flood is. So we want to just kind of touch on that flood that Joshua was talking about, this flood that came on from the other side of the river. And we want to know what river that is and know how to go into this. And the reason I guess I'm bringing this up because I had a question asked me today. The question was, if the children of Israel here that went through this migratory pattern and if the scriptures be true that they're all about Yahshua, the Messiah, and you have a group of people that are being used, how do we fit in? That's kind of the question. How does it affect us if it's about the Jews? If the Ten Commandment laws was for the Jews and the Jews only, and it wasn't pertaining to a Gentile, what's my purpose? What do I have to do to relate with this story or this event with Moses? Because after all, you're saying, our teaching is you're not under this sin. Mm-hmm. Right. So therefore, if I don't have a sin and this wasn't predicated to me, a Gentile, what purpose, how does this help me? Is where this is coming from, this flood topic. Okay. And so that's an answer that's a fair answer to someone that doesn't know Bible so much.
Yeah.
Now you hear about this Jesus and he's supposed to be coming back. But when he was here, as we were saying that, well, he was only dealing with the children of Israel. He was only dealing to fulfill this law. So how is he going to help me? Because they're the ones that messed up, and I've been living fine without anything. We haven't had no Yahshua the Messiah around for 2,500 years. So how does this help? How does the Bible help? How is it relevant to me? Is what the question was. And so I had to think about that way. How do you get a person to become settled and let them know about blood, water, spirit, 40, ascension, in return of this Pentecost, this spirit that's supposed to come out? Essentially, it's no different than it going up. Right? We say that the spirit came out 50 days later and it went into somebody. And so what?
Yeah.
What was the Acts, the second chapter, talks about a rushing mighty wind.
Right.
Went in and entered them. Well, that's not no anything different than them watching Yahshua Messiah elevate on some clouds in their consciousness. I just said the reverse. And what did it do? What has it done for me lately? You see? If I'm not to act like Moses, if I'm not to act like Noah, if I'm not to act like Joshua, if there's no one in there to follow up because it's about Yahshua, what do I take from that? This Bible and this book, in order to make me not be stressful, make me not have anxiety. How does it help alleviate these problems that I have that are all around me? That's the question. And so we have to be able to go into it some kind of way, logically, skillfully, in order to demonstrate how it helps them. Now, a lot of people say this. And the question was given to me today by the young man. He said, oh, that sounds Hebrew, right? Yahweh and Yahshua, they sound like Hebrew names. Okay. And most people are aware that Jesus in the Bible is a Hebrew Bible and given to the Hebrews. So my question was, like you say, you looked up trash. I looked up Hebrew, right? Hey, Sean, can you do that since you were Johnny on the spot with Flood? Maybe we can work it out. Because I research kind of differently than in a lecture format, so I need to be able to expedite it to make it make sense. Because Hebrew, the people think it has a land somewhere, right? A Hebrew nation. You're Californian. You got California, right? You from Spokane, Washington. You're a Washingtonite, right? Where are Hebrews from? Are they from Canaan's land? Where were they? What land were the Hebrews from? Oh, from the other side of the river. Yeah. Did they all come from the other side of the river?
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh?
The Jews?
Yeah.
And Gentiles.
So, grab me, 11, Genesis. So I'm going slow like this because some, you know, we oftentimes think we just know. You're Hebrews. You're a Hebrew. Yahshua was a Hebrew. But you don't even know where the Hebrew come from and who was deemed a Hebrew before anybody. Right? Because they say the name of Yahweh is Hebrew, as though that was a name derived from a nation, and it's not that. Because we say Hebrew is not even a Hebrew name.
Semitic language of the ancient Hebrews.
Right. But we all speak Yahweh. You say 156 in Psalms. We all breathe the name of Yahweh. We're not all Hebrews. So it needs to be broken down that Yahweh, as it says in the scriptures, he's not a respecter of persons. And you have a person talking about this event of this migratory pattern, and they're thinking it's about Hebrews or about the Jews and the Jews alone, because this is what this law was given to. And therefore, you have to be able to demonstrate that for a peculiar people that Yahweh just simply drew out from all the nations. You follow the Israelites.
And I have that definition.
Let's go ahead and get it for me, please.
I'm pulling this from Online Etymology Dictionary.
Okay.
And I'm looking up the etymology of Hebrew, adjective. Late Old English from Old
adjective
French.
Is an adjective, is an action. Right. Not a land. That's what I'm expressing.
Yeah.
All right, read.
From Latin, Hebrus, from Greek, Hebraios, from Aramaic, Semitic, Ebrai, corresponding to Hebrew, Ivri, and Israelite, traditionally from an ancestral name, Eber, but probably literally one from the other side.
One from the other side. This is as Dr. Samuel Salas made clear. Of the river or the flood. You follow?
Perhaps in reference to the river Euphrates.
The river Euphrates. Now we got the map here. Did the monitor freeze? Did the monitor freeze? Doggone it. It froze. Thank you, Samuel Salas. Yeah, it froze. It probably is not going to come back, neither. Yes, sir. Man, now I can't show it. The charts. Doggone it.
We still have audio.
Okay, we still have audio. I'm going to watch my mouth. It may come up.
You're all good, honey. I'm retired military. I swear worse than you do.
All right, well, I apologize because now this kind of throws me off because I really wanted to show where this River Euphrates was. And we're going to read Genesis, the 11th chapter, 27th verse. And what you're going to read is about Terah, which, as Dr. Samuel said, is Abraham's father. So we're going to read that down to about 32. Okay. Sean, I can't restart the camera? It's not going to work, huh?
You would need to stop OBS and restart OBS to get the camera to unfreeze.
I have charts in front of me.
Okay. I don't know what charts you have.
I have the same charts you have in class. I just have them laminated in a booklet.
Yeah, you're talking about the primary charts, right? I have a different chart that's showing a land of the Middle East.
Oh, I've been in the Middle East. I've seen the Euphrates. Does that count?
Possibly. We're going to read it a little bit.
Okay.
That's fine. At least we got someone that got a witness who's been there.
Really?
That's fine. That's all we help. Because we're here to draw out, right, and work together. You know, someone who's
that's
been
right.
there. And so we're going to read right quick, though. Let's go ahead and read Genesis.
Genesis 11:27.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these are the generation of Terah. Terah begot Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran begot Lot.
Mm-hmm.
And Haran died before his father Terah in the land of his nativity in Ur of Chaldees. And Abram.
And they were in the Ur of Chaldees, Terah, Abram, Terah who had Abram, Haran, and the other one. Right?
Yeah.
There's three. And Haran dies, and Terah has Abram. You follow? In the Ur of the Chaldees. Okay, that's what I want. In the Ur of the Chaldees, where they say is the start of the, you know, so keep reading.
Okay. And Abram and Nahor took them wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarah.
Mm-hmm.
And the name of Nahor's wife is Milcah.
Yeah.
Michael, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah, the father of Ishka.
Mm-hmm.
But Sarah was barren. She had no child.
We're aware of that. Sarah was barren. And Abram, that was his name at the first, when he first was born, right? Who has Sarah. Now keep going.
And Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, mm-hmm. his son's son, and Sarah, his daughter-in-law, his son's Abram's wife. And they went forth with them from Ur of Chaldees.
Now they went from the Ur of Chaldees, read. Mm-hmm.
To go into the land of Canaan.
To go into the land of Canaan. This is them, Abram, from the other side, being called a Hebrew. Mm-hmm. Okay, read.
And they came unto Haran and dwelt there. And the days of Terah was 205 years. And Terah died in Haran.
And Terah died in Haran. Now, that's them coming from the other side across the River Euphrates. So if you had the map, did you ever been to the land of Ur, the Chaldees?
What's her name? No.
Jessica? You're Jessica, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, you haven't been that far down in the River Euphrates. Nonetheless, Nonetheless, it's proposed to be the Garden of Eden or start of mankind in Mesopotamia here. And this would flood out. This river would flood out during the period of times. And that was the flood that Joshua was talking about of this time, whereby Abraham and his family crossed over that flood and ended up being in Canaan's land. You follow? And that's what that's what Joshua was talking about. And that Terah was a statue maker over here. Remember, they had idols. They worshiped El Shaddai. They didn't know him by Yahweh, right? But they did know the Almighty Provider. And they reference him as the El Shaddai. You can read that over there in Exodus, the 6th chapter, right? No man, no man knew the name of Yahweh, Abraham, Isaac, nor Jacob, right? They only known him as El Shaddai. But yet I'm bringing back the point of that Hebrew, and that it was referenced because of an action, not a land. So therefore, the name Yahweh is not beholding to anybody. You see what I'm saying? It's not a Hebrew name. It was referenced as though it was, but it's not beholding to any landmass or a nation or people, is where I'm coming from with that. So you'll hear that question. Oh, you speak in Hebrew. No. So therefore, that name is unpronounceable as a tetragrammaton. You have to have an understanding of how to put in the vowels in order to make it pronounceable as Yahweh. You follow? So therefore, there we go. We got it back. Woohoo! So this was the map I was talking about. Can you zoom in? Oh, you're good. We got camera back. You guys see the camera, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. There's the picture of the land of
modern-day Iraq.
Modern-day Iraq. There's Mesopotamia, right? And this is the river Euphrates. Down yonder here. You call that river Euphrates here. And this is the land of Ur, from where Abraham comes from. He that comes from the other side of the river. Grab me the 14th chapter of Genesis, 14 and 13. So that's just pretty much what I wanted to express as far as the flood and where they're coming from and how and why that river Euphrates is where Abraham dwelt and came from. Okay?
Genesis 14:13.
Genesis 14 and 13.
And 13. Mm-hmm. And there came one that had escaped and told Abram.
Now, Abram, before his name was changed to Abraham, they're in war, they're in battle. Abraham's fighting the Amorites and whatnot. Jessica, can you hit your mute button, I think, maybe?
Absolutely.
Somebody's dog is going. Go ahead and read. Thank you, Jessica.
For he dwelled in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite.
Now go back okay. And catch it.
And there came one that had escaped mm-hmm. and told Abram.
And they come to tell Abram the Hebrew. And he's telling him, they let him know what Abram is. He's the Hebrew from the other side of the river mm-hmm. or the flood. You follow? Keep reading.
For he dwelled in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol and brother of Aner.
Okay.
And these were confederate with Abram.
Okay, that's fine. Now, we want to get down to, what did I use? Hold on. Let me find it very quick. So that's Abram. That's letting you know that they refer to him as the one from the other side of the flood, okay? Now I want Genesis 8. Let's go Genesis 18. Now, also with Genesis, also with Abraham, we're going to talk about. Go ahead and catch this right quick.
Genesis 18 and 1.
18, I'm sorry.
18.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him.
Now, this is where I was stating, all the nations of the earth, We're not dealing with Abraham or a nation of Hebrews. He come from the other side of the flood. He's going to be used in order to build a nation of people. You follow? But the promise is for all the nations of the world. Reread what you have there. Genesis 18 and what?
18 and 18. Mm-hmm. Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him.
Now, surely Abraham is going to be a mighty nation. He's going to become a mighty nation. How is he going to become? Why and how is he going to become a mighty nation? Is what we need to understand. We're a person who's not an Israelite, who's not a Hebrew, realize that he's going to become a nation in order to be a father of all nations. Go ahead and read it.
Continue.
Yeah.
For I have known him in order that he will command his children mm-hmm. and his household after him, mm-hmm. and they shall keep the way of Yahweh to do justice and judgment in order that Yahweh may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken of him.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous.
Now, you're just talking about a period of time after they're in Hebrew, after they're in the promised land. He's walking the length and breadth of this time. And you have Lot, and they broke up their land, and Lot went to Sodom and Gomorrah, and Abraham resided there in Canaan's land. But here we're picking up the thought that Yahweh is going to make Abraham a great nation for the whole world. You follow? Because and all the nations of the earth, that's including everybody. And this is why Abraham was created or used in order to preserve this promise, right? Now, let's go down to Genesis. Now, skip over to Genesis 22.
22?
Mm-hmm. 22:18.
18?
But.
And in thy.
No. Hold on, it's 18. Okay, this is right after. This is right after he's went to sacrifice Isaac. Okay? Mm-hmm. We don't have the. We got one. Where is it at? Plate 23 of the 40 plate chart. Right? Let's go ahead and read down from. Thirteen. Yep.
And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by its horns.
Mm-hmm.
And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son.
Now, we're looking at the word flood in order to get why we got the word Hebrew. And now we picked up that Yahweh was going to make Abraham and his family a great nation. Mm-hmm. You follow? And then we have read there that he's going to do that for all the nations of the earth, which is going to include everybody now. We talked about a person not seeing the significance of the Bible, because if it's all about the Jews and it's a Hebrew Bible, what they got to do with me?
Mm-hmm.
You follow?
Right.
And if Jesus is not right and the whole racket's wrong,
yeah.
But we're trying to reel them back and get them from the start, right? To the law and to the prophets. If they're not speaking according to this, there's no light or understanding. So now we're going slow and demonstrating on maps and through the events of time through a vision, because we have to be mindful that Moses is seeing this.
Right.
Because he says Yahweh talked to Abraham, but Yahweh never talked to Abraham, right? But it reads that in King James' book. So we're being mindful, and someone has to be drawn from the milk and wing from the breast, right? And so this is what we're expressing. So we're just getting through this event, and we're down here on this pictorial illustration that Abraham was about to slay his son, which is his son being a type of Yahshua the Messiah. Okay? Isaac was going to be a type of Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading.
14. And Abraham called the name of the place Yahweh Jireh, as it is called to this day. Mm-hmm. Yahweh will provide. And the angel of Yahweh called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time, and said, By myself have I sworn, said Yahweh, for because thou hast done this thing, and hast not withheld thy son, thine only, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore.
You're talking about this multiplying now. Because Abraham listened and did what Yahweh told him to do. Yahweh, if you go back into the story, told Abraham to take a sacrifice, which was Isaac. And Abraham, in his consciousness, talked about that he was dead. Because that's the death principle in this Abrahamic story, you follow? That he saw Isaac as the sacrifice that he was going to have to give unto Yahweh. And he was prepared to sacrifice him. But we now know that this angel stayed his hand, you see. And there was a ram caught in the thickets. See, he's immersed in the thickets. And you have this lamb is going to be exchanged for Isaac. You follow? And that lamb or that ram, which is really a lamb, a ram is a full-grown lamb. Right, so you have Yahshua, who was the lamb slain before the foundation of the world here, you see. And now you have this lamb that's going to be exchanged for Isaac here on this altar. And then you have that angel being the spirit that intercede for Yahshua, for his stead, if you would, right? So you have the death within the minds of Moses. And then you have that ram submerged in the thickets. And then you have that spirit that stayed his hand. Now that's just the death, burial, and death, burial, and spirit, or resurrection, because you resurrected because Isaac was saved. That's the resurrection, right? That's the principle in that story. Now he's talking about saving all nations. Keep reading. He'll be blessed, and he's going to have more sons. Of the sea, of the sands of the sea, and the stars of heaven. Read.
And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. 18. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed.
Now in thy seed will all the nations of the earth, again, we're reiterating this earthly thing, which is going to include everybody. You follow? But we're going the way of the purpose of Yahweh through this nation of people that was created through Abraham. Okay, read.
Because thou hast obeyed my voice.
Mm-hmm.
So Abraham returned to his young men, and they rose up and went together to Beersheba.
Mm-hmm.
And Abraham dwelt at Beersheba.
Okay.
And it came to pass after these things that it was told Abraham, saying, Behold, Milcah, she had also bore children unto thy brother Nahor.
Okay, that's fine. That's going into another event. Yeah. Now, 26 and 4. Start at 1. Ooh, what time is going fast tonight?
Genesis 26 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a famine in the land beside the first famine that was in the days of Abraham.
Now we're talking about a famine again. Because now we're demonstrating that Yahweh overturns and overturns and overturns. He has Abraham up in Canaan's land. And now you have Abraham experiencing this famine. Read.
And Isaac went unto Amalek, king of the Philistines, unto Gerar.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh appeared unto him and said, Go not down into Egypt. Dwell in the land which I shall tell thee of.
Mm-hmm.
So journey in this land, and I will be with thee, and will bless thee For unto thee and unto thy seed I will give all these countries, and I will perform the oath which I swear unto you, Abraham, thy father. And I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of heaven, and will give unto thy seed all these countries.
Now remember, this is allegorical and analogies and metaphors that we're using in order to demonstrate or draw out a principle. You have four yet?
Yeah, I'm in it now.
Okay, go.
And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed.
Now, all the nations of the earth is going to be blessed through this nation or through this group of people here known as Hebrews. You follow? Don't have Israelites yet. Go ahead, read. Question? It's okay. Questions are good. This is a school.
If his people were going, Abraham's people were going to be all the earth, the earth was going to be blessed with his people. Wasn't there already people in the other parts of the world? I mean, you know, the earth had already been broken up, you know, after the flood of Noah. And there was people in those parts of the land that are not there. They're someplace else already. So how can, did his people go all over? I don't understand it. How can the world be blessed with his people if there was already people there in other parts of the world?
So the question is, if Abraham, you've got this map here. If Abram came from the land of Ur, right, and they were making idols, and they were worshiping various gods that they didn't know, not everybody was worshiping El Shaddai, the Almighty Provider, and you have Abraham that's going to cross this flood, across this river Euphrates, because you have a purpose that, give me Genesis, fourth chapter. I need the rivers.
Oh, okay.
Yahweh overturns and overturns. You have in the beginning with Adam and Eve, right? Was there multiple people when Adam and Eve came?
The descendants of Noah.
Hold on. You have Adam and Eve, which was the first man, and we all come from Adam and Eve, correct? All go to Matthew, the third chapter, gives you the genealogies from Joshua all the way back down to Seth, to Adam, and to Elohim, right? And they're coming out of this lineage. You have Pison in them rivers?
Yeah.
Start up a verse above there, read.
Genesis 2 and 7. Mm-hmm. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden.
Go ahead.
And from thence was parted and became into four heads.
Now you have a river that's coming out, just like you have this river Euphrates, which was up from Mesopotamia, the start of civilization, as we were expressing. They're coming out of this garden, crossing through or passing over, from a spiritual state of understanding into a condemned state of mind. You follow? You have Abraham that was going to be worshiping idols and not knowing anything about the Creator. And he's going to have to pass over a flood or go through across that river Euphrates, the same rivers we're talking about back here with Adam and Eve. Now, when you understand that it's going to be one purpose, right? And so when you see here on this chart, you see this timeline that Dr. Samuel Salas was talking about. Where we at? Moses, Let's see, Abraham over there. Yeah? There he is. Yeah, gotta be Abraham somewhere up there. There's Lot. So we have a purpose and we have a seed, because we talked about a seed that's going to bless all nations. You have Adam here, correct? We all agree to agree there was not a people on earth at that time. And therefore, we're all coming from out of Adam. But now when you get to Noah, he eradicated all the earth, correct? Eradicated, meaning destroy the earth at the flood. You follow? Sorry, eradicated.
No, I know that, but I couldn't understand how he eradicated.
But no, well, Yahweh eradicated the whole earth plane.
Noah didn't.
Yahweh did.
But, okay, Noah was Yahweh.
Noah was a vessel. That Noah had Yahweh speaking for 120 years through. And we have a lineage that we're expressing that came from out of Noah after the flood, whereby he had Japheth, Ham, and Shem. You follow? Now, this is still one nation, meaning the earth, there was no one populated the earth at that time, right? And you have the eight souls that came across that flood. Right? From the antediluvian age. Now, Japheth housed with Shem, because Ham, you remember, saw his father's nakedness. And his grandson, Canaan, was going to be cursed. This is where you got Canaan's land from. And so now you got Canaan coming from out of the Ham, the type of the satanic spirit, if you would, coming from out of Ham and that lineage. Shem showed forth the righteous lineage, you follow, that's coming on down through Arphaxad, Salah, Eber, Peleg, Reu, all the way down until you get here. Remember, they landed in Haran, right? That was a brother of Abraham, and then you have Terites and Amorites. Those are from off the offspring of Ham that they resided up here in, and so you have Abraham that's going to have this nation, and the nation is going to be the righteous nation. You follow? Whereby all the earth that's going to be able to learn and know about Yahweh is going to be coming through Abraham. We're done with Genesis. We just wanted to show the flood and the river.
Oh, the rivers, yeah.
And the rivers. And you're asking about all the nations. Well, all the nations, Abraham, is through Abraham that all the nations are going to learn from, because this is going to be a promise given to Abraham. So that all the people that are in existence, because they're all one family, we're all coming from Adam, and we're all coming from out of that line of Noah. And we're understanding that the nations are going to understand by way of the promise given to Abraham, the 28th chapter, we haven't got there yet, that was going to be for the whole world. Remember, this was set up, this lineage here that we see, you know, Moses lives, the judges, we went through Saul, and then all that was imposed on people. Did you understand what I mean by that, imposed on? Meaning they couldn't do anything other than what the will of Yahweh had them to do. And it's this purpose that the promise that Yahweh's telling Abraham, that all the nations, even though there's nations already in existence, they're going to come into an understanding of Yahweh. Go back to where you were reading on the thing when we get down to it. Was it 26?
before I went over to...
Yeah, 26 and 4, you're reading down.
And remember,
it's not literal. That's why I'm going to put that in there, too. This is... This period of time back here from Abraham through Isaac and through Jacob, that happened literally so. And now we expressed it that it's going to be for all nations. We read 4 again.
Okay. And I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of heaven, mm-hmm. and will give unto thy seed all these countries.
Mm-hmm.
And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed.
All the nations of the earth, meaning Hams, the Canaanites, all the nations are going to be blessed through Abraham. 28 and 14. Because we're just going in the chronological order of this blessing for all the nations.
Genesis 20.
They're already there. They don't know nothing about what's going on, right? They're worshiping the sun, the people in Egypt are worshiping the pyramids, the cows. Remember, we had 10 devastating plagues, and all those plagues was a god. And they're worshiping. They don't know nothing about Abraham, because we read there that went on down into Egypt because of the famine. You remember Pharaoh down here when Abraham, that we just read it there in the 26, there was a flood. He's telling Isaac to stay up here, but Abraham comes down with Sarah. Mm-hmm. And Abraham tells Sarah, hey, let them know you're my sister.
Right.
Because they'll kill me if they know I'm related to you. Mm-hmm. And he gives them, you can read the story sometime. I think it's there in the 26th chapter.
He didn't lie.
And he didn't lie, because it was his sister.
That's right.
Right? It was his sister.
Because
they were married within... They all come out of that line, that lineage.
Sarah was daughter of Terah.
Hmm? Sarah was the daughter of Terah. Okay.
With another woman. Abraham was a son of Terah with another woman.
Abraham was a son of Abraham with another woman.
Yeah.
Okay. So you got to go back and read that to catch the continuity, right? So I'm trying to express... that when they came down here, man, I need to get it, man. You can find it for me? The Pharaoh. So Pharaoh takes Sarah in when they get down here because of this famine. And this Pharaoh has a dream at night. And he's letting known, the spirit's letting Pharaoh know way down here that, hey, don't touch Sarah because she is married to Abraham. Right? Remember that story? So what I'm saying is that was another nation down here that was already there. It's not all going to come out of his seed, literally so. It's coming out of the spiritual understanding that we're going to draw from all of that's happening. You follow? So when he comes down here and the Pharaoh down here says, man, you almost caused me to have a problem with Elohim. Elohim is a pluralistic title. There's many gods and they use them, right? And he said, you're going to almost cause me to have a problem with Elohim because I'm not supposed to sleep with another man's wife. And this is why we say that this law that was given to Moses, the Gentiles did by nature the things that were contained in the law. So they had their rituals, they had their ceremonies, and they had their beliefs, right? And did you find it? You have Pharaoh that had compassion and said, hey, that's wrong. I can't sleep with your wife. You follow? So that's demonstrating that they had people had a conscience here and was demonstrating that the things that were in this 613th judgment statute and ordinances, various things was happening that the various people in other nations were doing that wasn't contrary to anything else. And therefore, the next morning, he gives Sarah back to Abraham. He said, hey, man, you almost caused me to err. Take her and take your gifts and get up out of here. You follow? So.
Pharaoh was sick and his family too.
Huh? Pharaoh got sick after that or during the time? He didn't have sex with Sarah.
No. Before, he tried to do that because Pharaoh killed the husband of the beautiful wife of the beautiful women, and he had the women.
Yeah, but he had a dream.
This is why Abraham say, "This is my sister."
Yeah, because he was afraid that he would be killed, so that Pharaoh could have Sarah.
Yeah,
he had to eliminate him. That's what I understand that he's saying.
That what?
That's
what I said going into this whole thing. I said he gave Sarah up, told Sarah, let them know that I'm your brother and go be with, you know, Pharaoh. But when I'm saying the Holy Spirit moved Pharaoh not to touch Sarah, you follow? Because I'm showing that the nature of people was the same nature that the children of Israel. They weren't any different. That's all I'm expressing. That's all I'm expressing. But they don't know Yahweh. The children of Israel don't know Yahweh. And so he's using Abraham as a vessel. That's why he's chosen them. That's why he had him come out of the land. Metaphor, he had him coming out of the, crossing that river, crossing that flood. Just like we had to, just like they had to cross the flood. Noah and them had to cross the flood and start anew.
Right.
You follow? Perfect. And now we're having an experience with Abraham down in Egypt. About a famine. It's the same famine that caused the 70 at the point in time to have to come back down into Egypt. Mm-hmm. Because he's showing that cycle, that up and down cycle. And it's through Abraham, which is our father, according to the Spirit. Not literally so. We're not trying to find a lineage back to Abraham. We're trying to find the lineage of that seed that was given to Abraham of that promise. 28th chapter and 14th verse, Genesis.
28:14.
Mm-hmm.
And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed.
Now all the families of the earth will be blessed, but they're blessed spiritually so. Because this is a promise that's heavenly. It's not a physical, literal promise, as though you want to get a particular geographical landmass. You're not going to receive anything physically. What you're going to receive is the seed that all the nations that was going to be promised going to be given to him. Exodus promise. What else is there? That's just 14?
We did 28:14. You threw with Pharaoh. And
yeah. Okay. You're going to find it anyways.
Yeah, it's in 12. Okay.
It is in 12?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I don't need it.
Yeah.
Promise. Go to Acts. Okay. So, that was a promise that was going to be for all the Israel, and they're going to have to do something for 400 years and go down into this land that they know not of. And it's going to be through Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, that we're going to receive this seed. And so when they come down at the appointed time from out of Canaan's land, the 70 or the children or the 12 tribe or the 12 sons of eight of Israel, they're going to come down. They're a type and a shadow of the sun, because it's expressed that out of Egypt have I called my son. You follow? So what you have is that Abraham being the father, and then you're going to have Isaac that's going to have Ishmael, which is still Abraham's son, but he's demonstrating a Gentile nation.
Right.
You follow? Mm-hmm. Pharaoh's still down here in Egypt, but we're using Abraham and the promise that was given to Isaac. Ishmael goes away. That's where you got them over there in Gaza, in the Gaza Strip, and then Israel and the other Hebrews are from Isaac. That's why they warring over there, right? Fighting in Jerusalem. And you have those two sides, just like you have Israelites. The Israelites, when you hear everybody else, were Gentiles. Same thing here. Just it's a smaller microcosm of the bigger picture. If that makes any sense. You have the Ishmaelites and Isaac. They're warring against each other, right? Now, that seed that hath come down and out of Egypt, has he called his son? Because he was supposed to come out here and worship Yahweh at this mount. Well, when Yahshua was born, he had to go down into Egypt, right? And now we're seeing this, the seed, the principle of the seed manifesting. He's come down into Egypt. Where are we at? He's born, right? Or conceived in Nazareth, born in Bethlehem, and then he flees or flies out into Egypt. You follow? Same thing that the children of Israel had to do. And so when they're coming out of Egypt, it's expressed that Yahshua is fulfilling, and is out of Egypt have I called my son. And we talked about this before. Yes, Joshua, the son of Nun, was down here, but that's not who that son is referring to. You're referring to all the 12 tribes of Israel, right? That were Jacob's offspring, great, huh? A nation of people, right? Which were Hebrews, because they all come from Abraham. And their father Israel is where you get the 12 tribes. You got Reuben and Judah and Gad and all the other tribes, remember, right? But as a body or a nation of people, they're coming up as Israel. And all the seed is in them. Now, when they get to the wilderness, they're supposed to worship Yahweh, right? They're going to worship Yahweh at this mount. You follow? And when you understand that Moses, I have to go back, because Moses, when they come down, and it's been 400 years here, Moses is born down here in Egypt during that 400 years. You know that he was born during a death decree, right? He was put in the River Nile, 40 years here. He comes out into out here to tend to his father-in-law's sheep. It's a type and shadow that Yahshua is the shepherd, and we're the sheep, right? Or his bride is his sheep, right? And so Moses, after 40 years, comes to this bush. Now, Moses is from the Levite nations, which was one of the 12 sons of Israel. And it's coming through Moses that receives the name of Yahweh, correct? Moses comes back down. He delivers the children of Israel. The children of Israel spend 40 years here. And they come up in here to Canaan's land, right? And they spend another 2,000 years from here, because by the time they get this law to this temple, that had been 1,000 years. And then from that 1,000-year period, Yahweh is still dealing with the Jewish nation, okay? And then when he comes to Zerubbabel, which I believe is another, there's 1,000 years, another 510 years to Zerubbabel, and then there's a 53-year separation at Artaxerxes. You follow? And then you come into King Herod with Yahshua the Messiah. Now, so you have that period of time until Yahshua Messiah's birth, right? His conception. And we're talking about, see, grab me Isaiah 7 and 14. This is not so clear, I know. See if this works.
7 and 14.
This is going to talk about the conception, but it might work.
Isaiah 7:14.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, Yahweh himself shall give you a sign. Mm-hmm. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel.
Mm-hmm. Elohim with us, read.
Butter and honey, keep going.
Yeah.
Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. Yet before his child shall know to refuse the evil.
That's fine.
And choose.
Grammy, Hebrews 2 Corinthians 3:3. Give me Genesis 12 and 1 through 3 first. I don't think we read this.
Okay.
Sorry. So, we have this flood in this antediluvian age. Noah comes in with Japheth, Ham, and Shem. Ham sees his father's nakedness, right? And that line depicts the satanic spirit, because we're looking for Yahshua, because that's who we need people to realize that's running their lives. The creator of heaven and earth, not just the Jewish nation. We have to demonstrate that this book is set up for us to learn from about our creator. And this is the way that he's demonstrating it for all of mankind. We can be high-minded and say, well, I wish he would have used the Asian culture, because I understand, I like their Buddhas and I like their nationality better. We're not dealing with that. We're dealing with Yahweh's purpose. And I'm speaking about people who wants to understand why we use the Bible. That's right. And I'm trying to demonstrate to them why it's so. Genesis 12 and 1.
Genesis 12 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now Yahweh has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee.
So he's in the land of Ur in the Chaldees. We read about that earlier. Mm-hmm. And he's telling Abraham to get out of there.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Just like he's saying, get out of Babylon now. Get out of your consciousness about how you think things should be. And understand Yahweh's purpose. And this is Yahweh setting it up with Abraham now. Keep reading.
2. And I will make of thee a great nation.
Now you're going to make of him a great nation. Now, like your question was, well, there's already nations happening. That's true. But we're using this great nation that was going to be given to Abraham according to a promise that's going to be spiritual. That's not going to be literal. That's what everybody's problem is now.
Right.
They're trying to look at things literally as though, where do I fit in? And we're trying to let people know that you can't fit into a physical world with a spiritual understanding. He says, Yahweh says, not of this world.
Right.
We're in this world, but not of this world. Why would you say that? Because we're of a spiritual understanding about a physical, while in the physical creation. We're still here. Because it takes the physical to understand the spiritual. If it wasn't about spirit, then we all be fine. It just be what it is.
Yeah.
But we want to get out of here according to into a psychological understanding. That's and right. not reside in a physical world.
That's right.
Keep reading and finish up there in Genesis.
2. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee.
Mm-hmm.
And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed.
Now all the families of the earth are going to be blessed because of Abraham and his seed, because there's going to be a work that's going to work down through the rest of this dispensation, through the fourth dispensation, which you're going to have Moses and the migratory pattern. You have Yahshua come in, right? He's going to live for 33 and a half years, and then he's going to take off the flesh, right? 2 Corinthians 3 and 3. Start at 3 and 1. My time is almost up.
2 Corinthians where is that? 3 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some other epistles or a commendation to you,
mm-hmm.
or letters of commendation from you?
Yes.
Ye are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men.
Mm-hmm.
For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim,
mm-hmm.
not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart.
Keep reading.
And such confidence have we through the Messiah towards Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of Yahweh, who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life.
The Spirit is giving the life. Not these physical things that have transpired. And we're trying to demonstrate that this promise that we just read that was going to be to Abraham is going to be fulfilled in the knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah. And it's through this knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah that all the kingdoms and all the nations of this earth plane can know something about Yahweh. But you need to have the Jews first. What's that? I think to the Jews first. To the Jews, I think it's the 24th chapter.
Where are we at?
To the 24th chapter of Matthew, I think. No. Jews and then Jews, Samaria.
24.
We might have to come back and visit this topic again. It didn't go so smooth. To the Jews first, and then to the most parts of the world. World. This should be Jews first. Maybe first Acts. Maybe Acts 1. I think maybe Acts 1.
1 and 1?
Power. Yeah. Start at 1 and 6.
Acts 1 and 6.
Sorry about this, guys. Not coming out so clean right now. But go ahead and we'll catch it here.
When they therefore were come together, asked him.
You have to understand Acts here. He's already resurrected, right? It's already been 40 days, and he's about to ascend, okay, and go into heaven and sit on the right hand of Yahweh. We're talking about this plate down here on the elementary chart. You follow? He's here. Go ahead and read.
Okay. Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?
Talking about restoring a kingdom. They're thinking it's going to be a physical kingdom because this is the Jews and he's only dealing with the Jews, right? Read.
And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the time or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power.
Yes.
But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea.
Now they're going to be the witnesses. The Hebrew nation, the Jewish nation are going to be the witnesses because they're the ones that Yahshua dealt with. He didn't deal with the whole world at that time. In the fourth dispensation, he's not dealing with the whole world. Read.
But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
That's the site. That's the outtake to the Jews first, then to Judah, then Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the world. That's why 7 years after, and that's after baptism, after Pentecost, he's talking about. Read.
And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
Mm-hmm.
And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing up into heaven? The same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem.
Now, they didn't know what those two men were talking about, that he's going to come in like manner. That's why you have the whole world thinking he's coming back out of the sky. At that then known time, they didn't know because they're looking up. And the two men telling them, why are you looking up? Because he's going to return in like manner. But they don't understand that until the day of Pentecost. When he's filled with, when they're filled with the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And that's why we can say he's already returned, Yahshua the Messiah. And he's entered into the hearts and minds of men.
Came as the Holy Spirit into them.
Yes.
And then they understood, but they couldn't understand until they got the Holy Spirit.
That's right. And it was only to the Jews first. Abraham, yes. It was his nation. It was the nation that came from out of Abraham that we see through the scriptures, everything transpiring, in order to get to this point. And it's at this point now that the report or the story now can be revealed. You follow? And it's going to be revealed to the Jews first, Abraham's lineage, if you would, and then to Samaria. And then to the uttermost parts of the world. And that's depicted when you have down here later, 7 years later, the preaching of the gospel of the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, which is the Holy Spirit and not a man on a cross or a man that's going to come out of the sky anytime. Right. He's the Holy Spirit dwelling in the hearts and minds of people now that everybody can be a partaker of and not have to be subjugated to restored carnal ordinances.
Right.
And people don't realize that. And this is what is problematic now and running rampant in the whole world, right? They're returning back to this place. They're saying that Yahshua Messiah did not nail the carnal ordinances to the chart. And us teaching this in this fashion and in this way, we're using the past patriarchs. As Yahshua Messiah said, he's not come to destroy the law and the prophets. We still use the law and the prophets. Yeah. But we use them to demonstrate to people and teach them about it, not to put them on the people to do.
That's right.
And that's how a person can be edified and can take away the skepticism, superstition, and the ignorance that that's they right. behold and not know anything about their creator, which just merely uses a set of people for a period of time, and now they don't have any no more power than anybody else do. And now it's all dependent upon knowing about Yahshua the Messiah. So with that bit of information, we'll conclude. It was a good attempt to explain something, but maybe we'll come back and revisit it and maybe line a few things out a little bit smoother than what I was able to do tonight. So hopefully you got something out of what was expressed. All praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude the end of our class tonight. Sorry for the overtime, but very edifying. Is there any announcements? Would everyone's, we have classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 to 9:30, and from Sundays from 11 to 1. We are at 1816 East Elmo Court, Ontario, California, 91764. So would everyone please stand and be dismissed with the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all